Welcome back. Another global issue, another global phenomenon, climate change. Climate change is a big issue for the poor and the rich, for countries all over the globe, from America to Africa. But some would say that only the black continent is going to be the dear price with the climate change. Others would say that no, the big powers should pay the price, as they are the main reasons behind all the sufferings of the planet itself. There are summits held in Paris and in Morocco recently, and big powers were represented. What are the accords? What are the agreements? What are the results and repercussions? We are going to have an expert who is going to answer all our questions regarding this latest summit, which was held in Marrakesh, in Morocco. We are very much delighted to have with us Dr. MAgid, the technical director of the Regional Center for Renewable Energy. A very good morning to you, sir.
Good morning.
Good morning, Dr. MAgid. Let's talk first, or give a quick brief over the climate summit that was held in Morocco. Of course, it's a follow-up to other earlier summits, if you'd like to elaborate.
Yes. Good morning. The summit that was held in Marrakesh, in Morocco, in fact, was the first one following the Paris Accord. Mm-hmm. Which was received with a global attention worldwide, and which was a milestone worldwide that all over the world, all countries agreed to somehow reduce the temperature, mm-hmm. or the increase in the temperature of the Earth to below 2 degrees centigrade. In Marrakesh, in fact, there were more than 44,000 participants there, from more than 190 countries, mm-hmm. more than the members of the United Nations itself.
Okay.
And the concept, the theme of this global convention, I would say, was to go to how to mobilize resources to realize the Paris Accord. Mm-hmm. And the title was Action. Let's Act. Mm-hmm. And in fact, there were a lot of hopes before the conference. However, the results of the presidential election in America was somehow shadowing what was the discussion there. Mm-hmm. And this was because of the American president's position toward change in general. However, the American delegation confirmed that they are committed somehow to the climate change cause, and they confirmed also that they will continue to work with the international community. And what was clear for us there, that the momentum is already there. So not a single country can stop what is happening worldwide. Mm-hmm. And that the global powers are somehow institutional countries. They build on institutions, and these institutions will maintain their obligations. Mm. And the fear that America withdrew from the Paris Accord, in fact, according to the accord itself, was there are some conditions that it would take at least 4 years to get out of this. Mm-hmm. And during these 4 years, a lot of things can happen. Again, the Marrakesh event was somehow different from all other previous conference of parties. That this, it is called like that, COP 22, mm-hmm. Conference of Parties 22. Those parties who have signed the Kyoto Protocol, first of all, and then in the 1994, and who followed
now
up the
more
action.
More than two decades now.
Yes.
Yeah.
And as I was telling you, that there were many hopes how to get this implemented. Mm. We have decided to do some action to preserve our planet, to mitigate the carbon emissions and so on, but what would be the actions? And there were reconfirmation, I would say, on the that the developed countries would commit $100 billion to developing countries to try to mitigate and adapt to climate change. Mm-hmm. And this is up to 2020. Mm-hmm. And in fact, the discussion was focused on how this resource will be allocated, mm-hmm. through which channels, which banks, which institutions, and so on. And in fact, there were many doubts from the developing countries mm-hmm. side that we don't want to be obliged, committed to do expensive measures while we have not contributed to the pollution problem all over the world. Mm-hmm. And with Detroit, there are what is called now NDCs, nationally determined contributions, mm-hmm. that each country says that I'm committed to reduce the emissions by a certain percentage. But this is, yes, I'm committed to that, but in case that I have been supported by the international community to cover part of my commitment. And
sir, we are going to turn back to Marrakesh and to the summit, but if you permit me, I do have some contradictory issues.
Yes.
For example, I have two examples. First, in Germany. By the year 2020 or 2022, Germany declared that they are going to get rid of all their nuclear plants.
Yes.
And they are meaning that they are going to get rid of one of the most important renewable energy resources. And number two...
Not renewable. Nuclear is not renewable resource.
I mean far from fossil fuel.
Yes, clean, okay. But not...
Clean,
yes,
okay. But, okay. And in Egypt, for example, we are now to have, or already we have power plants fueled by coal.
Not yet, but yes.
But we
cement
are.
Industry and so on, yes.
Yep. Don't you see that these are contradictory acts, as you've kindly mentioned the summit in Marrakesh, in Morocco, was speaking about acts, about action more than anything else. Whether a developed country like Germany is doing something far from this, and whether we are a developing country as Egypt, we are moving to use something which is less expensive because we don't have much finance to have other renewable energy resources, or at least to have both, not to depend on one. Don't you see that this is a little bit contradictory?
No.
The answer would simply, you please elaborate, sir?
Yes.
Because I don't understand
okay.
that much.
In Germany, a big portion of their electricity mix is based on coal already.
Okay.
And nuclear. And when they say that we are going to somehow reduce the size of the share of nuclear in their mix, coal remains there.
Mm-hmm.
But they are increasing the share of renewable to compensate for the decrease in the nuclear and coal. So this is a direction in Germany because that coal has polluted the environment there a lot. And they are trying to somehow reduce the effect, mm-hmm. mitigate the effect of this pollution that happened already there,
okay.
over the industrial revolution and so on.
Mm-hmm.
The case here in Egypt is different.
Okay.
In Egypt, we have already a mix that depends on conventional resources, fuel, which are natural gas, which is clean,
mm-hmm.
compared to coal and compared to oil. And minor percentage, around 10% of coal, and 10% of renewable energy already existing in Egypt.
Okay.
The majority of this 10% is hydropower, high dam and so on. And the orientation toward having coal to a certain extent in the energy mix is, in fact, somehow motivated by that the technology for generation of electricity through coal has developed a lot worldwide.
Okay.
There is now what is called clean fossil fuel systems
mm-hmm.
that they have, although the coal itself is polluting, if it is burned in an open way.
In an ordinary way.
Yes, but the new technology for generating electricity from coal is somehow now safe environmentally.
Okay.
However, as a pro for renewable energy, I'm not in favor of coal
mm-hmm.
on the personal level. And I'm not in favor also of nuclear, although this is a mix. However, I understand the motivation. I understand the reasons why you are going there.
Mm-hmm.
And in fact, I'm somehow supporting that we diversify our energy portfolio,
mm-hmm.
that we do not rely on a single source. Because any country that relies on a single source, at a certain point of history, will fail mm-hmm. to supply their own demand. Mm-hmm. And this is what happened to us 2 years ago when we relied, about 90% of our generation was relying on natural gas, and we suffered. And you remember
yeah.
the story there.
Yes.
Back to the Marrakesh event.
Mm.
What we was, in fact, getting a lot of attention there,
mm-hmm.
that it is no longer only climate change. It is now climate change to serve the development.
Okay.
When we are mitigating the environment, now it is a way to develop your own resources, your own economy in a more sustainable way, that you can produce the needs of this generation without sacrificing or jeopardizing the needs of future generation. And we have seen that we are talking on several aspects. Water security, food security, energy security, genders, jobs creation, many things that have been there discussed, and in what's called all things together in an integrated way. And this is, in fact, a new thing that is happening now. So us as energy professionals, we're not discussing only energy this time.
Mm-hmm.
We were discussing how energy can be used to eradicate poverty in rural areas.
Mm-hmm.
And then we were discussing solutions, for example, solar pumping, solar cooling, rural electrification system, and so on. We were discussing the desalination of water through renewable energy.
Mm-hmm.
We were discussing how to have enhanced planning, and this planning would somehow integrate all what you have as resources. We were discussing the health effect, the socioeconomic impact.
Sure.
So all these aspects together are now, it is no longer, I would say, isolated discussions that each group of experts focusing on their own narrow vision, but now it is more a global action. And each one, I have participated as a speaker in three events, in fact. And these three events, one of them was around water, food, energy nexus. And we have seen very nice examples. For example, about milk storage, how from the cow, you preserve the milk for small farmers, not for large industries and so on. You just preserve the milk with solar cooled systems, and then you reduce the wastes. So you increase the income for the farmers, and you have better quality for milk. Simple solutions that were developed. We were discussing, for example, how to hybridize, how to somehow replace part of the diesel generators in the rural areas that are pumping water for irrigation with solar system, solar pumped system that are modern in irrigation. And by this way, you would preserve water because there are, instead of having the flood water that irrigation, the flood irrigation that we are used to, we'll have driblets and so on. Modern system for irrigation. What about groundwater? Not to somehow exhaust it through over withdrawal to have your needs and so on. So there were many. This is only for water, food, energy, crops. What is the selection of crops should be if you are dealing with a system based on solar technology? Many things in this, only in this domain. Jobs created, the local content. What would be the jobs impact of you if you are following a trend that, for example, having a share of renewable energy more than 20 or 30%. What would, how this would impact the local industry? In each country, what would be the local content for these countries that would have higher impact on the GDP, in the gross domestic product, and so on. So this is the spirit of the discussion.
Right.
There were also some fears there that how, in fact, we are going to be treated as a developed country. What would be the base year for us? And the surprising number that Africa, and you referred to Africa in the opening words, that Africa only contributed to 4% of the pollution all over.
This is going to, was going to be my second question, Doctor. Of course, is this convention a follow-up for the Paris summit that was ratified by 55 countries? Those 55 countries are share in the half of the carbon emission and pollution worldwide. So
now they are 127, in fact. At the COP, they reached 127, and they are responsible for around 80%.
80%, so not only half
of the... Yes, and there were many initiatives among local municipalities, cities, small areas, to commit to 100% renewables. And there are another initiatives for 80% renewable of the mix. And there were amazing stories about how you can use your wastes to generate energy, electricity and heat to serve the community, and you become zero emissions, zero imports of fuels. And there were many examples, using of solar water heaters, using of photovoltaic modules, rooftop systems, using of, in fact, wind farms in urban areas.
Wind farms?
Yes.
Wind farms was my coming question, because I really do not understand what a wind farm is. And if this is the right translation of the word, wind farm.
A wind farm
is
simply a wind power plant.
Okay.
We call it wind farm or wind park because this are some sort of towers, like trees. And these towers are aligned together in rows. And so it's when you look from far, you see these towers like a farm. Okay. So this is why they call it wind park or wind farm. And the wind farm is simply we are harnessing the speed and the energy in the wind to generate electricity through rotating machine. And these rotating machines, in fact, the blades are very similar to the wings of the planes. And they are bigger than the Boeing 474 airplane.
Wow, really?
So this is the height. Now we have in Egypt, Egypt is number one on the Arab world in wind energy installations.
Okay.
And we have around 900 megawatt right now, almost half of the high dam. And these installations, you can see when you are going to Hurghada or Sukhna, you can see these wind farms there. Simply, we learn it in schools that when you have a motion and a magnetic field, the third thing is would be electricity.
Yes.
And what we do that we capture this wind speed to create a motion of these blades. And when these blades rotate, they would generate electricity. And we get this electricity to feed the grid, the electricity grid nearby. And the Egyptian experience in this domain started in 1988.
Wow.
And in fact, this is a wonderful success story. Because the area we started in large-scale projects, not pilot projects, is Zafarana. And Zafarana was an area of conflict between Egypt and Israel. And it was full of mines, explosive materials. And what happened because of we wanted
full
to...
Full of mines.
Yes. And what happened that we, in collaboration, I mean the Egyptian Renewable Energy Agency, NEREA, and the army, geared their forces to clean this area from mines and to use wind technology to power this area. And in fact, and we also created the road, the Sukhna road, you see now. And we connected the water pipeline from Kuraimat. So there would be electricity from wind, road, served excellently by the army, water resource. What happened there in the 90s and now, starting from the 90s, that this area became the Sukhna resorts. So this is an impact of wind development that was not seen before. When we developed this area, we were not targeting having it as a touristic attraction area, as a resort. But now this is what really happened. And we are proud that we reached this stage. And we see that renewable electricity can bring civilization into many spots in
Egypt.
Of course,
and everywhere.
Well, Professor Dr. MAgid Karamuddin, the Technical Director of the Regional Center for Renewable Energy, thank you very much for your input, sir. Have a very good day.
Thank you for coming, and I guess this brings us to the end of this edition of The Breakfast Show. My name is Tina Hussein. I had all the pleasure to have with me Nermeen Abdulrahman for this Saturday morning, and until we see you again tomorrow, that's a goodbye.
Thank you very much, Dina. It's a goodbye.